a virtual Bible study with Bishop Gary L. Hall, Sr. We are happy that you chose to join us on this evening. Remember to like, share, comment, and ask questions as we go through tonight's lesson. And join us in giving with the Givelify app as well as Cash App. Don't just watch. Worship with us from wherever you are. Now, let's go into worship and learn more of God's goodness and mercy.
Well, God bless you. We are thankful that by God's grace, we have been able to come again. And we're thankful for the privilege to greet you wherever you are in that precious name of Jesus. We're continuing our study on fasting from wrong thinking. Our leader and our pastor, Bishop Hall, has been leading us in this series. I do believe that if you go along with us in this series, that at the end of this series, you will have a metamorphosis in your thinking and in your mindset will have been changed if you just embrace the principles that are in our studies that we've been going over. Today we have with us on the panel, Ella McCray, Sister Nelson, and Pastor Brisbane, who will be assisting us in our discussion. Today, we are focusing on the problem-focused mentality. The problem-focused mentality. We are fasting from what we call the problem-focused mentality. Now, let's change that way of thinking today. And we're looking at item one for discussion. Never be satisfied with just recognizing a problem. There are enough critics and complainers in the world. The world needs solution-minded people, not just those who can report a problem. And I'm sure you can attest to that.
Well, we definitely, you know, have to get beyond just recognizing problems. A lot of times in corporate America, we're in those meetings, one of the biggest things that we find out, if you could point out a problem but you don't have a solution, then you become what we call a complainer. Mm-hmm. And so you have to have a solution to whatever problem that you recognize. That's the only way that change can happen. Because if you just complain about it and point out the problem, it exacerbates the problem, and then it stays there, it lingers, it festers, and it becomes something like a cancer in the midst of a group. Yeah. And so what you have to do is not only point out the problem, but look to God to find a solution for it as well.
Amen. That, I don't know if you remember this phrase from 50 years ago, in the Apollo 13 said, Houston, we have a problem.
Yes.
And I think that not only did they have a problem, but they had to find how can we solve this problem. Uh-huh. You know, we got men in outer space. You got a problem. You got to come up with some kind of alternative. How are we going to get these people back here on Earth? And I think a lot of times is that we it's so easy to point out that problem. But the thing is, how do we solve that problem?
How do we solve the problem?
Absolutely. Yeah. And it is easy. Sometimes we have people who very easily will see a problem, but never think about the fact that maybe before I report this problem, let me see what kind of solution I can offer. Mm-hmm. A lot of times we are so quick to see a problem, report it, be ready to point it out, but not have a solution to the problem. In many cases, even in people, when we see a problem with a person, and we feel like we must say something, we need to also have a solution. Mm-hmm. What can we do? You know, we're taught that before you criticize a person, you want to give them something positive first. You want to be able to say something good that they are doing. But before you point out the problem, have a solution. I have some friends, and this is kind of on the light side, you know, they like to point out the fact to me that my car is dirty. Mm-hmm. And my response is, well, what is your solution to that problem if it is a problem for you that it is? So, you know, they run away then from that solution. But it is easy for us to point it out. But let's be more focused on having a solution. The Word of God is full of examples where there were many, many problems. Mm-hmm. And one that comes to mind with Jesus and the crowd of people. Mm-hmm. And at first the disciples said, let's send them away. Yes. You know, it's time for them to eat. They're hungry. But Jesus said, no, we're not going to do that. Yeah. I have a solution to that problem. Mm-hmm. Yeah. So then we have got to follow the pattern that Jesus has set for us. And that is being a people who are solvers of problems, not just people that pointed out, because as Elder Brisbane said, that means that we're complaining about something and without any intentions of being a solution to what we see the problem as being.
Yes. Yes, that is so true. You know, that problem-focused mentality, it eliminates even the possibility of searching for a solution. The sole focus is on the problem without any possibility of examining a solution. And people, you know, are rewarded for solving problems. I thought about the life of Joseph when they had this issue down there in Egypt. And Joseph didn't just talk about the problem. He knew what the famine was, but Pharaoh needed someone who could bring a solution. And so Joseph gave him a solution, and based on the solution that Joseph gave to Pharaoh, he was elevated. And so people are elevated based on their problem-solving abilities. And so I think that leads into our next item. We are compensated for the problems we solve, not the problems we merely recognize. I think we have a lot in that area of recognizing the problem and being critical about the problem. But we need problem solvers. In many areas of society and in our lives, we need problem solvers. And then too, if many times we can't come up with an immediate solution, but there's no harm in seeking God, you know, for answers that we don't have. And for revelations that we don't have.
Yeah. And I think in my career, one of the things that helped me, receive promotions, get elevated, was I figured out how to solve problems. Mm-hmm. And I was recognized for being able to solve problems. Even some of the businesses I created was an answer to a problem that we saw. And by doing so, it helped me. And I think in our careers, even in ministry, it's a big thing too. And I talked to those leaders in our ministry, before you come up with a complaint, come up with the solution for it. And it's valuable to people when you're able to solve problems. It's valuable to situations when we're able to solve problems, when we're able to see something and be able to solve problems. Even some of the things that I was able to solve in my career, I went to God about it. You know, it was an issue that we had with our compliance. I went to God, what mm-hmm. should I mm-hmm. say about this? God mm-hmm. point me out to an idea, mm-hmm. a solution for this particular problem. Mm-hmm. When I did that, I was able to come up with some great ideas that helped move us forward.
Amen. All right. Love the math. Love the math. What do I mean? Mathematics is a great discipline because it prove there is a solution to every problem. Whether you lack math in school, we need to get this. There is a solution to everything.
I love this because I love math. Yeah. And one of the things that I love is solving equations.
Yeah, yeah.
And when you have an equation, you have two sides to the equation. And on one side, or maybe both, you have a letter. You do not know the value of that letter, but you've got to solve the value. You've got to find the value of that letter. But what you have to know is that there is a solution to that problem, to that equation. You, if you know how to do it and you follow the steps, then that's another area that we must do, and that is follow the steps. Then you will always come out with a solution. And it will be the right solution. So then it is important. Every equation will have a solution. You just need to follow the steps in order to get to the right solution.
So, Sister Nelson, you're saying that the equation is indispensable in solving the problem.
Absolutely.
You've got to use the equation because the equation is the formula.
Exactly. There is a formula that you follow in order to get to the proper answer.
All right. That's good to know. And that comes back to that mindset. And then, you know, we have to have discipline in our thinking too. We have to have discipline. You have the mind of Christ. You have the mind of Christ. And with this mind, you will find his solutions. With every problem man created, God had a solution. And you have his mind. Yeah.
You know, Philippians 2 and 5 says, let this mind be in you, which is also in Christ Jesus. And so we have to go after the mind of Christ. There was a saying years ago, somebody put it on bands or whatever. They had it on different things. What would Jesus do?
Yeah.
You know, but they were just using it as a little catchphrase, you know, but you got to really think about that. You know, when you take on the mind of Christ, you know, what would Jesus do in this situation? You know, what would Jesus say in this situation? We got to think like he think, you know, and only way we get to thinking like he think is what knowing what the word of God says.
Amen. The mind of Christ. You know, the word of God is the will of God. That's his will. And he's revealed to us in every area of life what his will is. God, you had, all right, lean on the Holy Spirit. I like that. Lean on the Holy Spirit. As we are led by the Spirit and pray in the Spirit, we bring his solutions into our situations. Romans 8, 26 and 27 says, the Spirit helpeth our weaknesses. But we do not know how to pray as we should. But the Spirit himself maketh intercession for us according to the will or the solutions of God. Now, that's very good. That's very good. Now, as I looked at that, I thought one of the basic functions of the Spirit in the life of the believer is to be our helper. I believe it speaks of that word in the Greek as the paraclete, one that stands beside you to help you. See, the one that stands with you to empower you. Acts 1 and 8, that empowerment that comes from the Spirit that helps our areas of weakness as human. We have human frailties and we are limited in areas that we can only do so much. That's when that spiritual and divine empowerment comes in to help our weaknesses. He is our helper. We made it this far because God's Spirit has been our helper. So learn to lean on the Spirit. Have the mindset to call in divine assistance when you have reached your limit. Amen.
Bishop, I think that says it all. Lean on the Holy Spirit, that helper. You know, in times when we need to speak, in times when we need to comfort other people, we have to lean on the Holy Spirit to give us what to say and how to say it, how to be able to solve problems within our life, within our ministry, within our families, within our communities. And I think it's really important that we lean on that Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit is there to help us in our weakness. And I think enough people don't lean on them.
Yeah.
I think a lot of times we try to lean on ourselves. We try to lean on our friends. We try to lean on our confidants. But we need to lean on the Holy Spirit more than anything else to help us, especially when we're dealing with our mind and the wrong thinking that we have compiled or compressed and put in there to lead us.
Mm-hmm. Yes, and I might add some in our audience today. Where have you been seeking your help? What have you been leaning on? What have you been depending on? What is your mindset? And where do your mind send you to get help when you feel your own limitation? Stop talking about the problem and start talking to it. Jesus said, if thou shalt say to this mountain, be removed and cast into the sea, and do not doubt, it shall obey you. Use your mouth to move the problem.
That is so beautiful, Bishop, yeah. In that we must stop talking about the problem and talk to it.
Amen. All right, we're about to conclude. There's so much. You may notice we're just giving you some nuggets of truth. We're not near about exhausting these topics. All right. Think it and say it.
And our declaration for the day is, I believe that God will give me the interpretation of life's problems and that he will bless me with wisdom and answers. I believe there is a solution to every problem because I have the mind of Christ. Amen. I welcome the Holy Spirit to pray through me and bring God's will and solutions to my life and to the lives of those around me in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. God bless you.
Thank you for worshiping God with us today. As we come to an end of our service, this doesn't have to mean goodbye. Stay connected with us and join us during our weekly interactive virtual Bible studies held every Wednesday night at 7 p.m. We hope that you were able to digest some of this good knowledge that we were fed on today. Hide his word in your heart as you carry him with you during your week. And come back and join us next week as we go even higher in the Lord.